So.
I'll have to remember that next time I take something.
Just move it. It's a spatial problem.
Okay.
Who'd like to play?
Oh, I'll play.
You was worth playing.
Good, then.
Player.
All right. How about reading that?
Oh, that's... All right.
We follow the ancient rule. And anyone who wants to say anything to stop the show, please do so whenever you feel it's appropriate. What? For any reason? Fair? The reason I have trouble with this dialogue is I don't know how to read the first sentence, and therefore I can't draw it.
I entered the grammar school of the teacher Dionysius. The first sentence. I entered the grammar school.
Well, why don't you just read it out loud so we don't want to see it?
Why?
Waiting for Bill?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fair.
I entered the grammar school of the teacher Dionysius and saw there the young men who are counted the most commonly informed and of distinguished family and their lovers. Now it chanced that two of the young people were disputing.
I had a problem with the first sentence.
Okay. Well, you can stop, so. I entered the grammar school. What's the problem with the first sentence?
The contrast. Is there a contrast there?
Grammar school and teacher?
Students and Dionysius. Students and lovers?
Yeah.
That's the first sentence.
Yeah, isn't it?
Oh, you mean all the way down. I'm about the first line.
Is that a contrast?
The lovers being in school?
Look here. Where did it go?
I entered the grammar school of the teacher Dionysius and saw there the young men who are accounted the most commonly informed and of distinguished family and their lovers.
Yeah. So, how shall I draw them? That's why I needed some help. Look here, would you mind reading again just once more? This is a very, very absurd and minor problem that I'm making into a molehill instead of a mountain.
I entered the grammar school of the teacher Dionysius and saw there the young men who are accounted the most commonly informed.
What is commonly mean? Commonly informed? What does that mean?
Not beautiful.
Huh?
No, what is
beautiful. Yeah, the most beautiful body.
Commonly?
Yes, commonly is beautiful.
Yeah.
It's a vision of beauty.
Right?
So, Marlboro. Read it again with that in mind and tell me how I should draw this picture.
Most beautiful one.
How about doing it again? Once more.
I entered the grammar school of the teacher Dionysius and saw there the young men who were accounted the most comely in form and of distinguished family and their lovers.
Well, look here. Shall we make these the, which one shall I make? Let's make over here
Well, it should be obvious by the ones that are most comely.
Yeah, well, I only can draw beautiful pictures. That's why I was having a problem.
Put a mustache on that.
Yeah, I mean, when you have art, when you have talent, you know, you're really limited by your art.
That's why I wanted me to draw.
Well, someone did. Look here.
Purple shiny ones.
Are there a group, is there a group that's supposed to be beautiful?
Right, yeah.
And what?
Best family.
And rich?
Distinguished.
Distinguished family?
That's rich.
They got things.
No.
Right, and?
They're lovely.
Are they equally beautiful, or is he making a contrast?
He didn't say, but.
It says the most.
And they're lovers. It doesn't indicate that they're not, their lovers are lesser, so.
See the problem I have?
Could you argue that with them?
No.
Oh, and they're lovers.
And they're lovers.
And they're lovers, yeah. So there's those guys, and then there's their lovers.
Is that a contrast?
Yes.
There are these guys and their lovers?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, then they don't share the characteristics, do they?
Yeah, beloveds are more beautiful than their lovers.
Right.
No, I didn't say that.
Well, then in that case, I know how to draw them.
Beards and glasses are the most beautiful.
It could be.
Right?
Oh, no.
I must be a.
No?
Can't just say, they look like ants.
Ants!
God!
I knew this was going to be a difficult dialogue, but I didn't know we'd quarrel over art.
You are taking no credit, no credit, right?
I'd be willing to throw out rich until we decide whether that's true or not.
Distinguished, yes, it's distinguished.
Well, okay. There's some, right, but somehow there is a contrast. Right, he's looking over here and he's looking over here.
Yeah, but on what basis?
What?
On what basis the contrast is made, I don't know if it's.
Well, in any case, would you not agree on this side, they're lovers?
That's true.
Of?
More beautiful.
These people.
Right.
Is that right?
Right.
Just wondering why they couldn't be lovers over here. But they're lovers of those that are being contrasted with them, is that right?
Yeah.
Curious dialogue, why they ends up by separating the two.
But I couldn't figure that out, so I didn't have to draw it.
Yeah, okay, it's a minor point.
They're lovers of beauty.
Yeah, minor point, so it's going on.
Now it chanced. That two of the young people were disputing. But about what I did not clearly overhear. It appeared, however, that they were disputing either about
Anaxagoras.
Anaxagoras. Or about Onopidas. Onopidas.
Wash your mouth.
How do you say that?
Winefoot.
That's Winefoot.
Oenopides.
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 So look at me.
Oenopides. It's like phonics, you know, you do all the X vowels and then all the consonants next to them. And
Oh, I see. And I couldn't deal with the axe there. Oh, I see. Look at that.
She used up her A and couldn't use
it. Yeah, couldn't use it.
You already used the A.
When you use up your A's, you got it, right?
That's right. You can't axe if you already used your A.
Yeah, well, go ahead.
At any rate, they appear to be drawing circles. Can you do that? And they were imitating certain inclinations with their arms, bending to it and taking it most earnestly. they were imitating certain inclinations with their arms. With their bending to it. To it. And taking it most earnestly. Drawing to the circle. Then I, for I was sitting beside the lover of one of the pair, nudged him with my elbow and asked him what on earth the two youngsters were so earnest about. And I said, is it then something great and fine in which they are so earnestly immersed?
Great and fine indeed. Why, these fellows are prancing about heavenly bodies and babbling philosophy.
Then I, surprised at his answer, said, young man, do you consider philosophizing to be shameful? Else why do you speak so sharply?
Paul, why don't you pick up? I have a sore throat from eating too much chocolate.
Then the other youth, for he chanced to be sitting near him as his rival in love, when he heard my question and his rival's answer, said, do you yourself no good? You do yourself no good, Socrates, by pressing this fellow with a further question as to whether he considers philosophy to be shameful. Do you not know that he has spent the whole of his life practicing the neck hold and stuffing himself and sleeping
like a jock football player.
So why do you suppose he would make any other reply than that philosophy is shameful?
That's a very difficult dialogue. I can't see. It's a question of portraying this artfully.
Mm-hmm. Who's who? You know, there's a rival and there's another guy.
Yeah, but like, isn't he on the wrong side?
He's a lover? They're both lovers then, right?
Yeah. Yeah, they're both lovers over here.
Yeah, these two, yeah.
I mean, why wouldn't he be over here?
With the most beautiful.
Yeah.
Well, those guys are engaged in heavy conversation over there.
Yeah, they're into rapping, right? They're into discussion.
Yeah, but these other guys are into love.
Right? This guy wants, right? Let's say there's an attraction over here, right? And therefore they're rivals. They're both lovers.
Mm-hmm.
Then why is Socrates sitting over? Why shouldn't we?
Well, I have a good picture of the difficulty in this style.
Well, he's in the lover's side.
Yeah, I thought that was strange too. He took right up with the lover rather than the beauty.
Yeah. Very peculiar. Unless he has some foul intent.
Probably. He's going to befoul them both and take
and be left there with the beautiful.
Right.
No.
that was intent.
Unlikely. Unlikely.
I haven't read the end of it yet. If you'd like, I'll turn to the
No. That would be a jerk.
He's going to scare him and move off.
No, you don't think so. Yeah. Well, let's hurry to the end so we can find them.
Now, this one of the two lovers had spent his time on humane studies. Whereas the other, whom he was abusing, had spent his on athletics. So I decided that I had best relinquish the other, whom I had been questioning, since he did not even himself set up to be experienced in words, but only in deeds.
The word humane is musike. Musike.
What does that mean, David?
Well, if you like, there's a pretty clear distinction between music and gymnastics and other dialogue. I don't know if it's fair.
Well, why might that be interesting for Socrates?
To see music and gymnastics arguing with one another?
Yeah.
I don't know.
No. And that each only has half. Right? That makes them both ineligible for Boston.
Yeah.
Right, in the Republic.
Mm-hmm.
What's the basic study?
Gotta have both.
They have to have both.
One's
and
too
then only then can they go on to the advanced start.
One's too hard or one's too soft.
Right. And therefore they're engaging in a field which in terms of the Republic they
only have half.
No, they have half.
They're outside the sphere of that kind of thing.
Yeah. They're outside the sphere. They can't enter that. So each is half-assed, which is why I drew it this way.
So you know how
they're sitting on the same chair, right?
Yeah.
Cheap.
No cheap at all.
Right. So look here. In the Republic, would you agree? You need music, and then gymnastics, and then after that you go into the arts. Right, arithmetic, etc. What's the last one again? I keep forgetting. Oh, how do you spell it?
D-I-A-L-E-E.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
So, what did you do just then?
I went to the window. That was studying music. And you had a book like.
Mm-hmm. More? Come on. Why did he shift?
From what to what?
Let's read on. Okay.
So I did. Oh, now this one of the two lovers had spent his time on music study, whereas the other, whom he was abusing, had spent his on athletics. So I decided that I had best relinquish the other. I take it the athletic.
No, go ahead.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm. Well, go ahead. Yeah.
Whom I had been questioning. Since he did not even himself set up to be experienced in words, but only in deeds, and that I should interrogate the one who set up to be wiser, in order that so far as I was able, I might get some benefit from him. So I think that's the one who was music.
I see it exactly opposite. I don't know. Who, he hadn't been questioning the athletic one, had he?
Yeah.
Is that who he'd been? Mm-hmm.
For my part, I took it to be the music, but I'm.
Oh, yeah. You're right.
For me. So I took it that he's going to talk to the one who's studying music.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
I said, therefore, I addressed my question to both in common. But if you think you could answer more credibly than he, I put the same question to you as I did to him. Do you consider philosophizing to be honorable or not? The next sentence.
Okay.
Then the two striplings.
And you'll tell us what you just saw.
Overhearing us speak, somewhat like this, were silent and seeking from their own contention, they became listeners to ours. I don't know who the us and the ours are. I thought he was talking to music and athletics and.
They put a question to both of them, didn't they?
But there were two people fighting. And apparently he's talking to someone else who, I'm not clear.
The two striplings?
Yeah, the two striplings, I took it to be the two people disputing.
But they overheard it, so he wasn't talking to them.
Yeah.
So they must have been over somewhere else.
Or
that was the comely beauty.
Oh, that's supposed to be beauty.
Oh, the two lovers are, that he sat next to?
No.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, do it again.
Then the two striplings overhearing us speak somewhat like this, were silent and seeking from their own contention, they became listeners to ours. Yeah, that's interesting, he's reversed it.
And now these guys become
lovers of them.
Silent, right? And they listen to the others, right? So he's reversed the tables, right? Yeah, how about that? I mean, he's got the beauty to listen to him.
Are the beauties the ones with the coffee cups in their hands?
Yes.
I thought they were drawing circles with their arms.
No, that, see, he's got that in his hand, but they're now reflecting and having a cup of coffee. See the truck?
Mm-hmm. Now they're listening. When they listen, they always have to have coffee.
Yeah.
Oh. Boy, they got that coffee quick.
Yeah, and see that line around them?
It,
that's their arena.
Oh, I see.
See, that's their arena. And they just broke through, and now they're... Now it's only appropriate to give them things that befit their nature.
Coffee. Broke through with silence. Ears.
Right.
They're
hot.
Hot ears. Red hot ears.
That guy is clever, isn't he? He got the beauty to listen to him.
Jeez, the guy's so clever.
You read it from me.
Just by asking what question?
Huh?
Just by asking what question was it that got him?
Do you consider philosophy honor, philosophizing to be honorable or not?
Why? Was that what they were doing?
Mm-hmm. Babbling philosophy.
Babbling.
According to the others' view, right? Mm-hmm.
Oh. But what were they actually doing?
Well, they were doing Pythagoras.
I think they wanted to find out what the guy was going to say about.
Because they may be, in fact, according to where this discussion may go, discussing something that wasn't honorable at all. So he caught him. Yeah, go ahead.
What their lover's sensations were, I do not know. But I myself, at any rate, was staggered. For every time I am staggered by handsome young people. For every time I am staggered by handsome young people. It seemed to me, however, that my young friend, too, was in a great flutter as myself. But nevertheless, he answered me in a most ambitious spirit. Most ambitious spirit.
Why, of course, Socrates, if I should ever consider philosophizing to be shameful, I should not account myself so much as a man, nor anyone else either was disposed to think so.
Here he pointed to his rival lover and spoke with a loud voice in order that his favorite might hear every word. And then I remarked, so philosophizing seems to you to be honorable.
Quite so.
Well, now, does it seem to you possible to know whether anything is honorable or shameful without knowing what it is fundamentally?
No.
Then do you know what philosophizing is?
Certainly I do.
And what is it?
Why, just what Solon called it. You know, it was Solon who said, and ever as I grow... And ever as older, you know, so
long. That's a tongue twister.
And ever as I older grow, I learn yet more and more. And I agree with him that a man who intends to philosophize should in this way be ever learning something or other, whether he be younger or older. in order that he may learn as many things as possible in his life. Now at first,
I felt there was something in his reply. But then, on second thought, I asked him whether he considered philosophy to be much learned. Whether he considered philosophy to be much learning.
Certainly.
And do you consider philosophy to be merely honorable or good as well?
Good as well, very much so.
Then do you observe this is a peculiar, this is as peculiar to philosophy, this as peculiar to philosophy, or do you find it similarly in everything else? For example, do you consider the love of athletics to be not merely honorable, but good as well, or do you not?
To him, my statement must be neither. But to you, Socrates, I acknowledge it to be both honorable and good, for I consider this the right view.
Well, now, in athletics, do you consider that much exercises love of athletics?
Certainly, just as philosophizing, I consider much learning to be philosophy.
And do you then consider that the lovers of athletics desire anything else than that which will cause them to be in good bodily condition?
Only that.
And does much exercise cause them to be in good bodily condition?
Yes. For how could one be in good bodily condition through little exercise?
Here I felt it was time to stir up the lover of athletics, in order that he might give me the support of his athletic experience. So I proceeded to ask him, "And you then, pray, why are you silent, excellent sir, while your friend here is speaking thus? Do you agree that men are in good bodily condition through much exercise, or is it rather through moderate exercise?"
For my part, Socrates, I thought even a pig, as the saying is, would have known that moderate exercise causes them to be in good bodily condition.
See why they were disputing.
Even a pig would know that.
They are rivals.
What a line.
So why should not a fellow who is sleepless and unfed, with unchafed neck and slender, careworn frame?
God, his friend. And when he had said this, the boys were delighted and laughed their approval while the other lover blushed.
Right? What's he doing when you say that? He's helping them, isn't he? He's really being very helpful.
Oh, isn't he? He's stirring them up. Okay.
Right, he's stirring them up. Right now, the beauties are laughing at the lovers. Is that right? Mm-hmm. God. What a dirty trick.
Well, do you now concede that it is neither much nor little, but moderate exercise that causes men to be in good bodily condition? Or do you bid defiance to the two of us on this point? I think it's you, Carol.
Against him, I should be only too glad to fight it out. But I am certain that I should prove able to support the theory I have put forward, even had I put forward a weaker one, for he is not. But with you, I do not aim at winning an unscrupulous success, and so I admit that not a great but a moderate amount of athletics causes good condition in men.
And what of food, moderate or much?
Well, the same applies to food.
Then I went on and sought to compel him also to admit that everything else connected with the body, when most beneficial, was the moderate thing, not the much or the little. And he admitted that it was the moderate thing. And now, As regards the soul, are moderate or immoderate things beneficial as adjuncts of it?
Moderate things.
And are studies among the adjuncts of the soul?
Yeah.
So among these also, it is the moderate that are beneficial and not the much.
That's right.
Then whom should we be justified in asking what sort of exercise or food is moderate for the body?
Oh.
The three of us agree that it must be a doctor or a trainer.
A doctor,
all right.
Right.
And whom should we ask about the moderate measure in the sowing of seed?
Well, sounds like I'd call it the farmer.
And whom should we be justified in asking as to the moderate degree and kind in regards to the sowing and planting of studies in the soul? At this point, we all began to be full of perplexity. Then, I, mocking at them, asked, do you mind, since we are in perplexity, if we ask these boys here? Or perhaps we are ashamed, as Homer said, the suitors were, and do not think it fit there should be someone else who will string the bow.
What's he doing now?
Calling your bluff. He's getting the
giving him
the silent beloved into the conversation.
Right. Right. Shall we ask these?
They seem to know a lot.
They're listening.
They're listening. They've been laughing.
All right, shall we pull them in? They're the philosophizers. Right.
Then as it seemed to me that they were losing their zeal for the argument, I tried to pursue the inquiry in another way and said, what, as nearly as we can guess, are the kinds of learning which the philosopher should learn, since he is not to learn all things or many things?
That puzzles me.
Which part?
The Dharma.
They were losing their zeal for the argument?
Yeah.
Well,
now that they're in a state of perplexity, they
right.
don't want to
perplexity.
Keep going.
He had to make a choice, didn't he? What was his choice?
Oh, I guess give up the argument himself or do something else?
Well, at this point, we all began to be full of perplexity. That I'm mocking them asked, do you mind? Since we are in perplexity, we ask these boys here, he's shifting the discussion, isn't he? Mm-hmm. So he has to making a choice, isn't he? Well, what's his choice? Because then he goes back to the group. He goes back to the original group.
They don't want to include the others.
That's true. What would happen if he went to the others? What would he be leaving?
He'd be leaving them.
That's true. I mean, his only interest at this moment was to cancel out those lovers and be with the beauties.
They'd be jealous.
That would be a great place to do it, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you dummies, I'm going over here.
Yeah.
But he doesn't do that.
Well, then, why not? What keeps him on the left? Right, he has a choice. Got it, like
they're story. Losing their zeal for the argument.
Okay.
They're not in there anymore. They're all kind right. of going, oh, well.
Which ones? The
well, then why not shift over here? They're losing their zeal.
Actually, I think he blew it.
He could have just
engaged them. The guys got him all perplexed, got him to a place where they didn't know the answer. He should have just left him there.
And then moved over here.
And got him picked up on those kids.
Right, and picked up over there. So what choice did he have at this point then? Right.
Could walk away with the beauty.
To give up the question.
Right, perplexity in the question versus beauty. Mm-hmm. Right? And some background, which we don't know. I mean, we know this background, but we don't know where they are individually. Right? So we'd have to then pick up the discussion and continue it with unknowns. So he's making a choice between beauty and perplexity, isn't he? Mm-hmm. So he's going to stay with the questions.
And it could have made a nice choice then.
Yeah, go ahead.
At this, the wiser one interjected.
The finest and most suitable kinds of learning are those which will bring him the most reputation for philosophy. And he will get most reputation if he appears well-versed in all the arts, or if not in all, in as many of them, and those the most considerable as he can, by learning so much of them as benefits a free man to learn, that is, what belongs to the understanding rather than the handiwork of each.
Well, do you mean in the same way as in carpentry? For there, you know, you can buy a carpenter for 5 or 6 minae, you know. But a first-rate architect cannot be got for even 10,000 drachma.
This guy's really made it, didn't he?
I don't know what that meant.
Six to 10,000.
Six, yeah, that's true. He, such, indeed, could be found throughout the whole of Greece. Is it something of this sort that you mean? When he heard me say this, he admitted that something like this was what he himself meant.
Something like that.
I next asked him if it was not possible for the same person to learn in this way nearly 2 of the arts, not to speak of many or the principal ones, to which he replied,
"You do not conceive me, Socrates, to be stating that the philosopher must have accurate knowledge of each of the arts, like the actual adept in any of them. I mean only so far as may be expected of a free and educated man. That is, he should be able to follow the explanations of the craftsman more readily than the rest of the company, and to contribute an opinion of his own which will make him appear the cleverest and most accomplished of the company, who may at any time be present in some verbal or practical exposition of the arts."
What name shall we give him?
Rhetorician.
He's dabbled in the arts, right?
Good.
Jack of all trades.
Jack of all arts.
Jack of all arts. Master of none.
Yeah, but he's not even.
Not even.
He's not getting into the, as it were, the mechanical. Mm-hmm. He's just theoretical. He's
talk about it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Can't do it. He can only talk about it.
I knew a guy in San Francisco who, whenever he'd go to a party, he would first inquire from the host who was going to be there and what their backgrounds were. And then he'd run out to Scientific America back issues, you know. And just, you know, spend a good deal of time preparing for just casual conversation with people, because that's what he was, you know. He wanted to appear exactly like I more I read this, you know, and more it's like this one. Huh?
What do you think about the latest find in neutrinos?
Like the great imposter.
Yeah, right. Doctors that never go to school, right? Yeah.
Just enough to get in the discussion.
Well, yeah. Cocktail party conversation.
What
do we call it? Sounds like a cocktail party conversation.
Let's give it that time, the cocktail party.
Cocktail philosophy.
Give him an olive.
Good, right.
A tapered glass and an olive.
Martini. The martini philosopher.
Right, yeah. Martini and Rossi philosopher. Never talk without a comment on whatever is being
the doers.
Yeah, the doers. Is it Bristol cream?
Then, as I was still unsettled in my mind
as to the drift of his words, I asked him.
Drift of his words.
Right. Sailing away.
It was drift of his words.
Yeah, right.
Great hammer.
Sure is. Well, drift of his words. Just drifting to the left.
Not quite sure what extension is. Do I quite grasp the sort of man whom you mean by the philosopher? For you seem to me to meet someone like their all-around athlete in contest with the runners or the wrestlers. wrestlers. I say wrestlers. The former yield, you know, to the latter in their particular exercises and are their inferiors in these, but are superior to the usual sort of athletes and beat them. I dare say it may be something of this sort that you would suggest as the effect produced by philosophy, or those who make it their pursuit. They yield to those who are first rate in an understanding of the arts, but in taking the second place they surpass the rest. And in this way, the man who has studied philosophy comes just next to the top in everything. That is the kind of person whom you appear to me to indicate.
You're quite right. Seems to me, Socrates, in your conception of the philosopher's position with your comparison of him to the all-round athlete, for it is precisely his nature not to be... Is this the other guy speaking? For it is precisely his nature not to be enslaved to any business or to work out anything exactly, so as to let his application to that one matter, make him deficient in the rest, as the craftsmen do, but to have a moderate contact with all of them.
Well, after this answer, I was eager to know clearly what he meant, so I inquired of him whether he conceived of good men as useful or useless.
Useful, I should say, Socrates.
Then if good men are useful, are wicked men useless?
Yeah.
Again, do you consider that philosophers are useful persons or not?
Well, yeah, they're useful. Well, actually, they're more than useful. They're most useful.
Come now, let us make out if what you say is true, where these second best men are also useful to us, for clearly the philosopher is inferior to any particular adept in the arts.
Okay.
Well now, I went on, if you yourself or one of your friends for whom you feel great concern should have fallen sick, would you fetch that second best man into the house with a view to obtain health, or would you summon the doctor?
On my part, I should have both.
Can't answer. Please do not say both. But which of the two would you prefer and also summon first?
No one.
Gorgias would love this, right? Gorgias would love this. Take the rhetorician with the doctor to persuade the patient.
That's right.
Forget about the doctor. All you need is a rhetorician.
And I convinced him to take his medicine.
And
no
again.
One would make any question about that. The doctor should be preferred, not the woman first, okay?
And again, if you were in a ship that was making...
Yahoo!
To which would you rather address yourself?
It's a moon ball.
It's an interesting comment.
Well, I usually lock myself up when the moon is
one of the great pleasures in life.
And again, if you were in a ship, can you imagine? They go run down to the boiler room. That was making rough weather, to which would you rather entrust yourself and yours? The pilot or the philosopher?
I'd choose the pilot.
I should choose the pilot, too. And so, it will be in every case, so long as there is some craftsman, the philosopher is not useful.
Is that a question or a statement?
I'm not sure. And so it will be in everything else. So long as there is some craftsman, the philosopher is not useful.
Not useful?
Apparently.
Starts with a statement.
See, if you did it from the beginning, and so will be in everything else?
No.
As long as there's some craftsman, the philosopher is not useful.
Well, I agree with him already.
Maybe you should take my position.
So now we find that the philosopher is useful, is a useful person.
Mm-hmm.
Useless. Useless. Oh, okay. And so now we find that the philosopher is a useless person. For I suppose we always have craftsmen, and we have agreed that good men are useful and bad ones useless.
That's right.
Damn.
Then what follows? Am I to ask you, or will it be too ill-mannered?
Ask whatever you please.
Well, my aim is merely to recall our agreement upon what has been stated. The matter stands somewhat like this. We agree that philosophy is an honorable thing, and that philosophers are good, and that good men are useful, and wicked men useless. But then again, we agree that philosophers, so long as we have craftsmen, are useless, and that we always do have craftsmen. Has not all this been agreed?
Yep, that has.
Sure. Then we agreed, it seems, by your account, if philosophizing means having knowledge of the arts in the way you describe, the philosophers are wicked and useless so long as there are arts among mankind. But, and I expect they are not so really, my friend, and that philosophizing is not just having a concernment in the arts or spending one's life in the meddlesome stooping and prying and accumulation of learning, but something else. Because I imagined that this life was actually a disgrace. That this life was actually a disgrace. And that people who concerned themselves with the arts were called sordid. But we shall know more definitely whether this statement of mine is true if you will answer me this. What men know how to punish horses rightly? Is it those who make them into the best horses or some other men?
Those who make them into the best horses.
Later we might ask why he shifted gears and introduced this thing, but it wouldn't be appropriate now to ask him.
Why not?
Do you need your phone?
Could I?
Just a moment.
Is that your phone?
No, that's his phone.
I figured that was going to get him. I mean, we got tape recorders and two phone things.
Is that your
phone? No, it's my tape recorder. Is that your tape recorder?
I had listened to that for what must have been years.
That's right.
I suddenly discovered.
I thought it was always the phone, too.
No, every 30 minutes.
No, but I figured it was since Pierre said it, you know, he was the one who did the brunt of being dumb.
Bumped in the hallway.
All right, thanks.
That's what I always thought. Nina, your phone's going off.
Thought I was being a nice guy telling her. I didn't know where she was bugging the giant.
No, it's fine.
Why is it appropriate to ask that question at this point?
Because that would be interrupting what's going on. I didn't want it to.
You've never minded interrupting before.
Besides, he never said in the beginning that whenever we had a question or made an observation that we could interrupt.
Of course,
that was a standing
rule. Well, why is the theme of punishment being introduced at this point?
Punishment?
Yeah, would you read the question
men,
again, please?
Oh, what men know how to punish horses rightly?
Wouldn't that be evil men?
Philosophers are wicked.
Wicked? Evil?
Whether or not they're sordid.
What's he doing? Suddenly, and there appears to be certainly a tangent from this whole discussion. Yeah? So here we go into right,
new theory, right? Punish horses. Right?
Because I imagine that
this is
life is actually a disgrace.
Right.
And that people who concern us are called sordid.
And if you punish them rightly, then presumably you're going to make them into the best horses. Right?
Punish right.
Is that a craft?
It's an art.
An art.
The art of punishing horses rightly.
Well, I'm going to go out and kick a few horses today. I know how to kick them right, boy.
This is why it's considered to be not a genuine dialogue, because it just, none of it fits. Let's go, okay? Just.
Those who make them, okay. Or again, is it not the men who know how to make dogs into the best dogs that know also how to punish them rightly?
Yes.
Then it is the same art that makes them into the best dogs and punishes them rightly.
It appears so to me.
Again, is the art that makes them into the best ones and punishes them rightly the same as that which knows the good and the bad ones, or is it some other?
It's the same.
Then in the case of men also, will you be prepared to agree that the art which makes them into the best men is that which punishes them rightly and distinguishes the good and the bad ones?
Certainly.
That's distinguishing, right?
So you have to have the knowledge of the good.
And that which does this to one, does it also to many? And that which does it to many, does it also to one?
Yep.
And so it is also with horses and everything else?
I agree.
Then what is the knowledge which rightly punishes the licentious and law-breaking people in our cities? Is it not judicature?
Yes.
And is it any other art than this that you call justice?
No, only this.
And that whereby they punish rightly is that whereby they know the good and bad people?
It is.
And whoever knows one will know many also?
Yes.
And whoever does not know many will not know one?
I agree.
Then if one were a horse and did not know the good and wicked horse, would one not know which sort one was oneself?
I think not.
It's a great question.
You see that on a, you knock on a door and you ask that question.
If you were a horse.
And did not know the good and wicked horse. Would you one not know which sort of one was oneself?
If you had it written in a little pen.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, well, you're a man horse, or can you tell?
About 3 o'clock in the morning.
2:02 on Sunday morning. On the door.
Put it in. Have a fortune cookie.
If you were a horse. I'm not dogs.
And if one were an ox and did not know the wicked and good ox, would not. Would one not know which sort one was oneself?
That's so.
And if one were an ox and did not know the wicked and good oxen, would one not know which sort one was oneself?
I don't know what the beautiful one is.
That's right.
And so it be if one were a dog.
Yes.
Well now, when one is a man and does not know the good and bad, one surely cannot know whether one is good or wicked oneself, since one is a man also oneself.
That's right.
And is not knowing oneself being tempered or not being tempered?
Not being tempered.
So knowing oneself is being tempered.
Yes.
So this is the message, it seems, of the Delphic inscription. That one is to practice temperance and justice.
It seems so.
And it is by this same art that we know also how to punish rightly.
Yes.
Then that whereby we know how to punish rightly is justice. And that whereby we know how to distinguish our own and others' quality is temperance.
It seems so.
Then justice and temperance are the same thing.
Apparently.
And further, it is thus, you know, that cities are well ordered when the wrongdoers pay the penalty.
That's true.
Hence, this is also statecraft.
Mm-hmm.
Again, when one man governs a city rightly, is he not called a despot and a king?
Yes.
And he governs by kingly and despotic art.
Yes.
And these arts are the same as the former?
Apparently.
Again, when a man singly governs a house aright, what is he called? Is it not a house manager and master?
Yes.
Then would he also govern his house well by justice or by some other art?
By justice.
Then they are all the same, it seems. King, despot, statesman, house manager, master, and the tempered man, and the just man. And it's all one art. The kingly, the despotic, the statesman, the masters, the house managers, and the justice, and the temperance.
It is so, apparently.
Then if it is disgraceful in the philosopher to be unable, when a doctor speaks about the sick, either to follow his remarks or to contribute anything of his own to what is being said or done, and to be in the same case when any other of the craftsmen speaks, is it not disgraceful that he should be unable when it is a judge or a king or some other of the persons whom he has just instanced, either to follow their words or contribute anything to their business?
It must indeed be disgraceful, Socrates, to have nothing to contribute to subjects of such great importance.
Are we then to say that in these matters also he is to be an all-around athlete, a second-rate man, taking the second place in all the subjects of this art, he the philosopher, and is he to be useless so long as there is one of these persons? For that first of all he is to entrust his own house to nobody else, and is not to take the second place in it, but if himself to judge and punish rightly, if his house is to be well managed.
Yes, that must be so.
Secondly, I presume, whether his friends entrust him with an arbitration, or the state charges him to determine or judge any matter, it is disgraceful for him, my good friend, in such cases to be found in the second or third place, and not to leave.
I agree.
Hence we see, my excellent sir, that philosophizing is very far from being much learning, and that affair of busying oneself with the arts. Hence we see, my excellent friend, that philosophizing is very far from being much learning, and that affair of busying oneself with the arts. My excellent sir, that philosophizing is very far from being much learning, and that affair of busying oneself with the arts. On my saying this, the cultivated youth was silent, feeling ashamed for what he had said before, while the unlearned one said it was as I stated, and the rest of the company praised the argument.
Cultivated youth. I didn't hear that statement.
Seems to be an unfinished dialogue.
Should I encourage him to speak louder?
Go ahead.
You trail your voice in the end, so I don't know whether you noticed that.
Well, I don't notice. But appears to be an unfinished dialogue. Seems like it could be much more.
Well, this is where you need words like because.
Seems to be fundamentally, I mean, on the logical level, you know, he refuted the learned youth, so you go back now with the athletic one and then return to the others there and then wrap it up that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's obviously a weak dialogue with the tangent.
Yeah.
Right.
Real tangent.
Horses and dogs.
Are you saying that? Disagreement?
To Steve?
When you said
a real tangent.
Some tangent. You mean it's not a tangent?
I don't think it's a tangent.
That's where you need the same word because.
Well, because it looks like he's moved from the arts or he's taken philosophy, which was in the second place, and shown that it has a place where it is useful and is in first place. And that the crafts, as I take it, are in second place.
Philosophers think that that's dark thought.
That's what?
Dark thought. Good enough. Right.
I didn't say we needed that dark thought.
I thought you said that too. You would want to go to a dark point contest.
I did.
So you want to take a philosopher.
I think he delivered somebody of a view they had about philosophy.
True, true.
And about themselves.
True.
Yeah.
True.
Also chastised the view.
True.
The beautiful over there thought they knew.
Keep going.
Well,
keep going.
The transition in the digression was concluding that the view of philosophy was sort of disgraceful, meddling, and that at that point, after I think at that point the idea was delivered. And then he chastised it and used it. I think that's part of what the horse from the dog.
Hmm. Take a look at that last part. Read the last paragraph for me, please.
On my saying this, the cultivated youth was silent.
Oh, well, I'm winning, now.
So we can use Barbara's chore.
And
feeling ashamed for what he had said before.
Right, he's done. Okay. Ashamed, right? Silent. Ashamed. Yeah, go ahead.
While the unlearned one said it was as I stated.
Then he agreed with Sock. Right? It was as I stated. Yeah.
And the rest of the company praised the argument.
Mm-hmm. So, as a consequence of getting into this discussion, what did he achieve? Pardon?
Everybody's benefited by it.
Good.
Everybody's what?
Good.
Benefited.
When he walked in, they were talking their song. Mm-hmm. He got them to talk their song.
He silenced. He ended up silencing one of them.
He silenced one of them. You called it chastised. Is that punishing? Mm-hmm. Is that punishing rightly? Mm-hmm. Making them better?
Better horses.
Making them better horses?
Is that what he's doing? Yeah. And if he makes them better, is he making them better lovers? Because they're into philosophy, as far as we know. What did he now do with the gymnastic? What did he pull them into? He's pulling him into philosophy, isn't he? Yeah. He agreed, he saw it. He was made better then, wasn't he? Yeah. He was made better.
And these other people probably saw him differently, not as a pig either.
Yeah. So therefore now we can recognize him. We can recognize him. What are we finding? He's the bad one, that's the good one. Now we can make the distinction. This discussion allowed us to do it, didn't it? Right? Now we can profit by it. Before, it looked like he was the dope and he was the bright one. Yeah. No, this guy has real good instincts.
No, he went
and that's what you needed.
He had the benefit of a single training and an excellence in one thing.
Yeah.
So it was real fun to get through, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So then that wasn't a tangent. Was that to your conclusion, Paul?
Yes.
Ah, I see how you did that. A lot of fun, that one, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Very
fun.
Short, very nice and
sweet.
Right? Nice and neat.
When it mentions about the horse that didn't know whether it couldn't distinguish good horses and wicked horses,
yeah.
When he mentions that, the word for good horses is the same word as the word for useful earlier. So you might say useful horses, and I don't know the Greek words in that. I just noticed that they're the same. 136E, where he talks about useful, good men are useful, he uses the word crazimo. And 137E, when he does the thing about if one were a horse and did not know the good and wicked horses, the word for good horse there is Christus, which he must be using it with the same meaning as useful. But this guy can't over it in the English translation. Any connection? I don't know what the word Poneros means. Maybe David could.
What was the name of the... Was not the superintendent of the building was from?
Poneros? I think so. It means foul.
Poneros? Yeah. Yeah, okay, that's helpful. Well, what dialogue do we go in next time? In our list of the midwife?
What about the synod group? The synod?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Do we still have the list around? Of the, how many people want to do?
Yeah, I have the list. I'll get over here.
Are any other names on it so that we can then decide on whether we want to take rent a bus? David, you hear that?
No. You're going to rent a bus?
Yeah, this set of people called me and said that Malty now is raised to the level of wherever she is, in the hierarchy, the boss.
She even has a name you can't pronounce.
Yeah, yeah. They call the girl Mai. And
Chid Velasananda.
Chid Velasananda, right you are.
I even brought her a picture.
Yeah, and they said that... they were interested in people with a background in philosophy and academics entering in and participating with them, and they would adjust whatever program they would have for us. And said if we went, they'd give us a front show and things of that nature and an opportunity to say hello to her. They suggested either last Friday or the one coming up.
You mean next Friday?
Yeah, this Friday, next Friday coming up.
Uh-huh.
And we decided that a bunch of us said, well, if the number of us are willing to do it, let's get a bus together and we'll go down in the bus and have some fun. Then come back and find a house to have a little coffee and talk when we come back. If so, put your name on that list with what that Barbara has, and we'll proceed tonight and see if we can firm it up.
Okay.
All right, or if you know anyone else at the college who might want to go along, or any friends, please invite them.
Yeah.
And why don't we have a cup of coffee and decide about it? Because is it not time for a good cup?
Yeah.
And in any case, what's the next midwife dialogue we're going into?
Midwifery. The Alcibiades I, Alcibiades II, Hipparchus, and Terastai, Diages, Carmody, Lachi, and Lysis.
And therefore,
as the good lovers would give in.
That's the other one, section they gave to
it. And Terastai?
Yeah.
Yeah.
How about
Diages? Diages or Carmody?
Yeah.
No, we haven't done Carmody.
No, there we go.
Have we?
seminar, but not in the series again.
Carmenes.
Charmides, right? Okay, we can put that in our hat for our next trip around, whenever we do it. Okay, good. That's a little longer.
Yeah, sure was.
Yeah, there's two things in that, right? At the end of it. Right. Justice and temperance are the same.
Is that nice? What is it?
And tyranny and law and kings.